So, after the somewhat extensive projects I've done recently, I felt like jumping into a bit more of a laid-back quickie this time around. So I was just doing my own thing, going through the nu metal vault, if you will, and then it hit me. Remember the Union Underground? The late 90s to early 2000s rock scene was very much dominated by all the shapes and sizes of nu metal. And in that era, just about anything that was in any way nu metal would get some kind of exposure. And amidst all that was a little band called the Union Underground. They're a name that hasn't exactly stood the test of time, and in this case, it can be understood why. They only ever put out one album before then disbanding only 2 years later, and said album didn't exactly stand out too much in a genre that was very crowded at the time. But you know me, my music taste is all kinds of stuck in the early 2000s whack. So here I am, talking about this group right here, right now, in 2022. Only on this channel. Now, some people might not know this, but this band actually came back. Somewhat. First in 2016, when they started doing shows again, and even teased a new album, which never ended up happening. And then again in 2020, although the band has been marred by difficulties surrounding the pandemic. And all that mixed together with the band's not so active socials means that, personally, I don't really know what the current state of the band is. Wikipedia still lists them as active, so I guess I'll go off of that, but whatever. That's the here and now, and we're here today to take a look into the past, so without any more further ado, let's rewind to the short-lived story of the Union Underground. Before we get into this band's short peak, however, we must start at the beginning. And this story begins in San Antonio, Texas, back in junior high, with the friendship of future band frontman Brian Scott and guitarist Patrick Kennison. After bonding through music, the pair would start up their own little makeshift recording studio after high school, naming it Studio Underground. There, they started making cassettes of their music, and eventually, after managing to sell over 5,000 copies of their 1997 demo EP, they caught the attention of a number of labels, and the Union Underground would eventually sign with Portrait Records, a sister label to Columbia Records, after the band's lineup was finished with the additions of drummer Josh Mimolo and bassist John Moyer. The signing was then followed by the band's debut and, well, only release, 2000s and Education in Rebellion. The album was largely made up of material from the band's independent work, and its title, An Education in Rebellion, was inspired by the band's journey up to that point, calling it personal in an interview as it represented how the band members decided at a young age that this was what they wanted to do in their lives despite what everyone else around them thought of it. Before we get into the music though, first the album cover. At first glance, it sure screams edgy nu metal to the max, and yeah, that's about right. I guess you can't go wrong with a creepy little girl. According to the band's bass player John Moyer, the blue tint of her skin on the cover art actually wasn't from makeup or effects, but rather the cold that the young model was in as the 3-hour-long photo shoot took place in freezing New York weather, which doesn't really sound too considerate to me, but let's just let that slide for now, I guess. I really wonder what this girl is up to these days. Anyway, when we look at the track list, we immediately notice how short this album actually is, clocking in at about 34 minutes, and that's including the intro. So not only did these guys only ever put out one album, that one album is about half an hour in length. But anyhow, the record's lead single was track 4, Turn Me On, Mr. Deadman, which became the disc's and also the band's most successful single, peaking right outside the top 10 of the mainstream rock chart at number 11. It's a song mocking the stereotypical rockstar image and lifestyle, and its title is taken from the whole conspiracy theory whatever regarding the Beatles song Revolution 9, where if you play a part of that track backwards, you can apparently hear the words Turn Me On, Dead Man.
And I put it on, and it said very clearly, number 9. And when I played it backwards and spun it backwards, it said, "Turn me on, dead man. Turn me on, dead man." Whew. I freaked.
Turn me on, dead man. Turn me on, dead man. Turn me on, dead man. Turn me on, dead man.
Now, despite this track being the band's biggest song, I have to admit that it wasn't ever really one of my personal favorites on here. I suppose it is a good representation of the whole disc, with the track having this industrial vibe to it, like the rest of the album. This song specifically always reminded me of Power Man 5000, namely their song When Worlds Collide, and I've seen other people share this sentiment online too. I still think it's a pretty good track though, and while I said it's not my favorite cut on here, it is pretty catchy, and I even remember this song being stuck in my head for a while at one point or another. Lastly, a little side note perhaps, this track alone actually allowed the group to tour with Marilyn Manson in October of 2000, as apparently he had heard this very song play at a strip club, which then led to him handpicking the Union Underground as tour mates. You really can't make this up. Going back to the album, however, I'm just gonna go out and say that it is definitely no masterpiece. There's a reason this band never blew up as much as some of the bigger names we remember today. This album has a pretty generic sound overall, not really offering much of anything that wasn't already being done elsewhere, and I can understand that perhaps people at the time thought this way too and didn't give this record too much of a chance. However, despite it not necessarily sticking out, it still does what it sets out to do rather well, I think. It might be generic nu metal, but it's not trying to be much more than that, and it's still some pretty good generic nu metal. Sure, I wouldn't say the entire album is a home run, with some forgettable cuts to be found, namely on the second half of the tracklist, but there is definitely some good material to find here as well. Drivel, the disc's first track after the intro, is a good example. I remember listening to this album for the first time and hearing this song and instantly being hooked into it. It's very simple, but it has this funky, catchy as all hell vibe all throughout its sub 3-minute runtime. I think it does a great job of kicking things off. As a listener, you know what you're getting yourself into right off the bat. No funny business, no secrets, just some harmless, solid nu metal. Sure, it does have that ever so dated late 90s, early 2000s feel to it, but I personally think that that's part of the magic, and that vibe is present on this whole album cover to cover. After Drivel, we come to what easily is my favorite song on here, with South Texas Death Ride. And yes, that title already says a lot about it. This song, similarly to Drivel, is very simple, but it takes that simplicity, runs with it, and succeeds with flying colors in my opinion. The track makes heavy use of repetition, but it works so well because of its crazy in-your-face energy. Does it scream 2000? Absolutely it does, but once again, that's what really makes it work, I think. This song doesn't try to be anything deep, it knows exactly what it is, and that's a total mosh anthem, perfect for losing steam. Honestly, that chorus, despite its repetition, never gets old for me. Listening to this song makes me feel like I'm a WWF superstar in the Attitude Era. And honestly, that's kinda how I would describe the Union Underground style in general. Early 2000s wrestling nu metal. The style, vibe, attitude, it's all there. I of course understand that this kind of sound is most certainly not for everyone, but I personally do have a soft spot for it. Nothing complex, just groove and aggression. Love it, and this cut is definitely still up there with my favorite songs to listen to whenever I'm peed off. And luckily, this album still has more to offer. Even though there definitely is some filler here and there, there are also some other bright spots, like the underrated track 5, Until You Crack, which takes the formula from the past songs and again, just flies with it, resulting in another simple and catchy nu metal jam. But the band does slightly switch up their approach on the song Revolution Man, however. This track was another one of the album's singles, and though I have not been able to confirm it, it seems to be written about the murder of John Lennon, featuring a couple of song references and lines about loading a gun. I read some theories about this online, and well, I thought it was all rather convincing. It definitely doesn't sound too far-fetched, considering the title of the album's lead single was also linked to the Beatles. Whatever the case, it's interesting to at least keep in mind. But then the song itself. It does not immediately start with pedal to the metal, and instead uses a little atmospheric build-up that leads to the main part of the song. The quieter moments have this very on-edge feel to them, and this is without a doubt the most experimental moment on An Education in Rebellion. Now take all of this with a grain of salt, of course, as despite the song title, it isn't a complete revolution, but in the context of this album, it definitely is a standout track, and I also really like the main riff that kicks in once the song gets into gear. Overall, this is a record that I can only really recommend to people who are nu metal diehards. I don't think anyone outside that demographic would be able to find much here, especially since the sound on this album specifically can be very dated, on some tracks more so than others. Again, I think this album is best described as early 2000s WWE nu metal. It has all that attitude that perhaps hasn't aged perfectly, but still has a charm to it. It definitely isn't for everyone, but with how rather questionable my music taste is, I can't help but enjoy this record. To me, it's just a fun, harmless nu metal album. It's simple, straight to the point, and aggressive as hell. Perfect for whenever you're in an irritated mood and need to let loose of some steam. And that 2000s as all hell dark vibe, it's like a time capsule. Sure, overall it might sound a bit generic, but at the same time, this is a perfect representation of the time period. And these days, this album really feels like a 34-minute long trip back to the year 2000. Now, An Education in Rebellion would sell about 350,000 copies. Not enough to warrant any RIAA certifications, but certainly no mean feat either. And the band would also get to play on the Ozfest tour in 2001. Fully solidifying their status as a true member of that whole nu metal era. Unfortunately, the band members wouldn't be able to enjoy this for too long, however, as the whole rockstar journey would come to a sudden halt the very next year, in 2002, when the band's label, Portrait Records, folded. The label had already long been struggling to stay afloat, and when it finally drowned, it also meant the end for the Union Underground. Before all this happened, however, the group was able to leave one final stamp on the scene in 2002, in the shape of what might just be the best wrestling song ever. I mentioned earlier how the band's sound could be described as WWE nu metal, and well, the Union Underground certainly embraced that when they put out the song Across the Nation. Now get the guns, the drugs, to my generation, I'll take the fall. This track appeared on the 2002 WWF Forcible Entry album, and would also be used by the WWF, which was renamed to the WWE that same year, as their main theme for Monday Night Raw all the way till October of 2006, when the band itself had already been long buried. In fact, Across the Nation was the Raw theme for longer than it took for the group to disband after their album release. Kinda funny if you think about it. But what about the song itself? Well, it might be nostalgia, but I meant what I said earlier. This might really just be the best wrestling song ever. Definitely one of the best at least. It's easily my favorite Raw theme, and hell, it was followed by a Papa Roach song, so that means a lot coming from me. This track is synonymous with the Ruthless Aggression era, and just takes me back to the old SVR times whenever I listen to it. It's also a perfect hype track. There's no way you can put on this song and not get pumped up. Of course, it does have a lot of that dated 2000s kind of attitude, but honestly, that just once again adds to the overall charm for me. I can say without any shame at all that I've had many moments listening to this song where I was just imagining myself as a WWE superstar in my mind. Anyways though, the Texas Outfit would also get to put out a live album later in 2002, titled Live One Nation Underground. but that proved to be the Union Underground's last ever release before their run was cut short. After that, when the group disbanded, its members all moved on to different things. Patrick Kennison founded the band Heaven Below, Josh Mimolo became a born-again Christian and devoted family man, and frontman Brian Scott would found the band Cult to Follow years later. But most notably, bassist John Moyer quickly moved on from the Union Underground to become the bass player for Disturbed, a role he's still in today, and logically, that's what he's most known for now, having been part of the lineup since 2005's 10,000 Fists. So the days of An Education Rebellion are mostly just a distant memory these days, even if the Union Underground has sorta made a comeback. Now, I don't really know what the future holds, but I guess time will tell. For now, however, that was the short-lived story of the Union Underground. As I said earlier, it's pretty understandable why this band's name has faded throughout the years. You don't have to look much further than the band's one album discography to figure that one out. Still, this group and album do have their own little cult following these days, and I am also among those people that come back to this release every once in a while. Of course, it's nothing mega remarkable, but on an occasion when all you need is some simple, straight-to-the-point nu metal, it does the job. But on that note, that's gonna be it from me. Let me know in the comments below if any of you still remember the Union Underground and An Education in Rebellion. As always, I love to read your thoughts. But for now, my name is F.A.D, thanks for watching, I hope you enjoyed, and I'm gonna see you guys in my next video.